Hello everyone, I'm Stanley Palisada. It's 9 a.m. in Manila, 10 a.m. in Tokyo, and 12 noon in Sydney. Our headlines: Asian markets poised to end the trading week higher as Wall Street rallied over a less aggressive remark by a Federal Reserve official. Here at home, the PSEI will kick off trading from the 6,600 level after adding 0.2% yesterday. Chris Mangan of ManganOnMarkets.com will join us for his analysis. Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. sees a planned establishment of two hyperscale data centers in Luzon as a boost for the government's push for digitalization. And the Malaysian government says it's willing to settle with other banks involved in the 1MDB scandal. We begin with an update on the financial markets. U.S. stocks rallied following comments from Atlanta Federal Reserve President Rafael Bostic about his favored path of interest rate hikes for the central bank. He is pushing for quarter point increases. The Dow jumped 1%, while both the S&P 500 and the tech-heavy Nasdaq gained 0.7%. An analyst says market volatility will continue as investors brace for the Fed's moves.
I think right now the market is just continuing to grapple with this tug of war between, you know, where we are in this economic cycle, and is the Fed perhaps relenting from, going to pivot here down the road, and perhaps that's what the market is hoping for. My sense is, you know, we're a year into this aggressive Fed rate hiking that we haven't really seen how that's all played out. So we're going to continue to see this volatility for the time being.
Taking a look now at U.S. stock futures, Wall Street could see a negative session when trading resumes tonight, Manila time. Inflation in the Eurozone eases in February. It slightly slowed to 8.5% last month from 8.6% in January. Most of the declines in prices were recorded from the energy sector. But costs for most other items like food and services were again high. Concerns are renewed on whether the European Central Bank will impose an oversized rate hike this spring. European markets still closed higher amid a relatively low inflation reading. In other foreign stories, a boost for Indian tycoon Gautami Adani after a stock rout triggered by a U.S. short seller report hit his conglomerate. U.S. boutique investment firm GQG Partners has brought shares worth nearly $1.9 billion in four Adani Group companies. This is the first major investment in the conglomerate since it was accused by Hindenburg Research of improper use of tax or offshore tax havens and stock manipulation. GQG told Reuters it has been following Adani for 6 years and believes its assets would not be low forever. Meanwhile, Citigroup is reportedly cutting hundreds of jobs across the company. Bloomberg says among those affected are employees in its investment banking division. The layoffs are said to be routine cuts that are part of Citigroup's normal business planning. The move comes weeks after rival JP Morgan Chase also cut hundreds of mortgage employees. The Malaysian government willing to settle with other banks involved in the 1MDB scandal if the proposals are reasonable. In an exclusive interview with ANC, Malaysian Prime Minister Anwar Ibrahim, also finance minister, says while they don't expect to recover all the funds that were lost, the deal should be fair. Two Abu Dhabi state funds embroiled in the scandal recently agreed on a $1.8 billion settlement with the Malaysian Sovereign Fund and the Ministry of Finance to end a legal dispute in London. Anwar has also asked Goldman Sachs to pay up after the bank admitted its role in the scandal. The 1MDB scandal saw billions of dollars siphoned from the Malaysian Sovereign Fund, which led to the ouster of Najib Razak as Prime Minister. The fund remains the subject of corruption and money laundering as investigations in several countries continue.
It could not have happened in that scale if the international financial institutions like Goldman Sachs is not complicit to the crime. So it's a tough stance. And we cleared it to the Goldman Sachs. And it's not right for you to say now we'll pay you some minor compensation. Yes, it was done by the previous administration, which I think was clearly not complicit, but at least certainly didn't focus on these issues. And I've changed. I've dismissed the legal team and the entire team and work again, because I think I owe it to the Malaysian people. I mean, why do we need to pay billions of dollars to the complicit crime of others? So I take that position, and we are reopening, of course, the case and negotiations with Goldman Sachs. And they can't say, well, it's over. No, it's not over.
Philippine senators hold deliberations on bills seeking to reform the country's real property valuation and assessment system. Under the proposed measures, the Finance Department's Bureau of Local Government and Finance should maintain internationally accepted valuation standards. The government study showed 70% of local government units have outdated property valuations. They stand to gain a total of nearly 38 billion pesos should the measure be passed into law. Now, the deliberations were held by the Senate Committee on Ways and Means, along with the Committees on Local Government and Finance.
The BLGF strongly supports the proposal and is committed to lead the reform. It is high time that we pass the proposed Valuation Reform Act, this 19th Congress, to make our property valuation system efficient, equitable, transparent, and reliable. Further delay in the passage of this reform would hamper the government in addressing the delays in various infrastructure programs due to the issues on right-of-way acquisition. So at the same time, the RP VARA will positively impact land administration.
Global consumer goods giant Procter & Gamble inaugurates its new 864 million peso manufacturing facility in the Philippine province of Laguna. The facility is designed to manufacture mainly diapers as well as soaps, laundry detergents, and other cleaning agents that will be exported to Korea and Vietnam. The Trade Department touted the plant as a direct outcome of the so-called CREATE law, which reduced corporate taxes. It's also seen as the Philippines' link to the global value chain for manufacturing and distribution across Asia. Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. lauds a planned establishment of two hyperscale data centers in Luzon. On Thursday, executives of ENDEC Development Corporation and Diode Ventures briefed Marcos in Malacañang regarding their proposed data center project in Tarlac and New Clark City. The palace says the proposal was a result of Marcos's roundtable discussions with American business leaders in New York last year. Marcos notes the project will enable the Philippines to catch up with other countries in terms of digitalization. He asserts the push for data centers is one of his priorities. ENDEC says it is committed to starting the project in the first quarter of 2024. The sale of old LPG or liquefied petroleum gas tanks now banned in the Philippines under a new law. The details from Alvin El Chico.
Eatery owner Marisa Estacio is dismayed that her new LPG tank, which she purchased for more than 1,000 pesos, was replaced in recent months by an old and dilapidated cylinder.
Paluma ng paluma hanggang sa naging hindi na talaga makita ang pangalan. Minsan kinakabahan nga ako, kaso sinisigurado ko rin sa nagde-deliver sa akin. Sabi ko sa kanya, tingnan mo kung baka may singaw yan.
Authorities claim a legitimate cylinder should bear the permanent mark or trademark seal of the brand owner. Based on the new LPG law, selling dilapidated tanks are illegal, and consumers now have a choice to change brands under the LPG exchange and swapping program. Information dissemination of the new law is one of the objectives of this year's LPG summit.
Hindi na sila dapat tumanggap ng mga substandard, dilapidated, we call it generic, yung walang mga brand.
It is
nandilimahid. It is now officially illegal, and there is a criminal aspect.
For the Energy Department, the consumer's power of choice is the essence of Republic Act 1159-2.
Siyempre, ang primary objective ng batas is safety, di ba? We cannot compromise safety. Sa iba't ibang distribution chain, dapat nandun yung health, safety, security, and environment.
The new law clarifies that a tank is not owned by the consumer. Ownership remains with a brand name, but consumers are entitled to a refund of the deposit.
Whatever the cylinder quality is, as long as ito yung brand mo, kahit luma yan, yung naka-indicate sa resibo, yun ang ibabalik sa'yo. Pero kung wala ka ng resibo, then there is the so-called agreement between industry participants, including the DOE, and that is around 800 pesos kung walang resibo.
Even the transport of cooking gas cylinders now has standards for motorcycle, tricycle, and four-wheeled vehicles.
Lahat ng kailangan na pang-deliver, especially yung two-wheel to four-wheel vehicle, ay kailangan nakahawla siya. Ito ay nakakulong para kung sakasakaling magkaroon ng aksidente, hindi kakalat ang tanke.
Meanwhile, LPG manufacturers implement a reduction of 3 pesos and 50 centavos per kilo last March 1, much lower than the amount of increase last February, which reached over 11 pesos per kilo or more than 120 pesos per 11 kilogram cylinder. Alvin Olchico, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine transport regulators grilled in a Senate hearing into the Public Utility Vehicle Modernization Program. Senator Grace Po asserts its implementation is unclear. Po says while she welcomes the deadline extension for individual jeepney operators to join a cooperative or corporation, there must be a sustainable solution to the program.
Well, the attempt to have this program roll out has started as early as 2017. So clearly there are people still in the agencies who have been pushing for something that has not been working. You don't need rocket science to know that a jeepney driver who earns about 750 pesos a day cannot afford to buy a vehicle worth 2.3 million pesos. Kulang ang 160,000 pesos na subsidy. Kaya naman sa ating panukala, not just and humane PUV modernization ay isinusulong natin na hindi dapat bababa sa 20% ang subsidiya ng gobyerno at 15 years to pay.
Transport regulators meanwhile insist the industry consolidation is not synonymous with phase out.
The deadline for December 31 is not for the phase out of the jeepneys. The deadline is only for the consolidation, urging the drivers to come together, consolidate as one, and start the formation of a cooperative in pursuit of the modernization. What we are just trying to seek at this stage is just the consolidation. Wala pa po kami sa stage ng phase out. Malayo pa po yan. There are multi stages po itong modernization program.
As the world marks Women's Month, advocates are raising awareness about the health of women in the Philippines. A health tech startup hopes to uplift the state of Filipino women by providing a better health and wellness experience for them. For more on this, we are now joined by Jessica De Mesa. She's a co-founder and the CEO of Kindred Health Incorporated. Good morning, Jessica. Thanks a lot for joining us today.
Good morning, Stanley. Thank you for having me here today, and happy Women's Month.
Happy Women's Month. Now, Kindred, simply put, is a healthcare for women by women, but it is definitely more than that. Please tell us about the concept of having this holistic approach to women's health and well-being promoted by your group.
More than happy to, Stanley. So Kindred is an all-in-one destination for women's health. And what we're trying to do is we're providing end-to-end solutions from trusted and compassionate and non-judgmental healthcare professionals, whether that's virtually or in person. We make sure that we provide a safe space for women, because we know that the social stigma and taboo around women's health issues have many harmful effects. So it's important for us to open the conversation and break the culture of silence so we can empower Filipinas to actually take charge of their health. at the same time, we have a holistic approach because we want to make sure that we celebrate a woman holistically as opposed to isolated body parts or systemic, because it's important that we're also taking care of our mental health and our mm-hmm. physical health and well-being as well. Mm-hmm. One of the things that we're very, very good at is infusing hospitality and technology so we can increase access to quality care and make it less complicated and easy to navigate. And we're also bridging our online and offline clinics to provide high quality care so we can allow that continuity in care and high patient adherence as well.
All right, that's quite a handful now. Of course, you've mentioned already the stigma and then the conversations that need to happen. What other specific pain points have you addressed, perhaps, when you envisioned something like Kindred in the Philippines?
Yeah, definitely. And the social stigma is a systemic issue, right? It's, I think, in traditional healthcare settings, it's always an uncomfortable and intimidating environment. We all know as well as that accessibility and affordability is a challenge for us when it comes to healthcare. Mm-hmm. We've also lagged behind in innovation. Mm-hmm. And because of that, we don't have all of the women's health solutions available in the Philippines, and we're trying to change that. It's important for us to make Filipinas aware and educate them on what steps to take to take better care of themselves, because when they do, it's important for community building. It's pivotal to the community building because we're important in the sense of family planning and sexual and reproductive health as well. It's a fragmented approach, as I mentioned, in traditional healthcare. So we're utilizing technology in order to progress and in order to fix that.
Okay, now you've mentioned a lot of innovation there. Particularly catching is personalized healthcare plans. How is this different from perhaps the usual healthcare services offered by mainstream institutions and even doctors? And how are women warming up to the possibilities you're offering?
Yes, definitely. I'll answer your first question. In a traditional setting, sometimes and most often, actually, it's a very transactional approach. Mm-hmm. But women are more complex. So women's bodies are more complex. And there's always a big learning curve throughout our life journey, from puberty to getting pregnant mm-hmm. or trying to get pregnant to menopause even. It's important for us to provide comprehensive plans of care and treatment mm-hmm. because, for example, a patient with PCOS or polycystic ovarian syndrome, it's not just the ovaries that has the problem. Mm-hmm. Sometimes because of the hormonal imbalance, sometimes they break out in acne, sudden weight gain. Mm-hmm. It takes a toll on their mental health as well. So it's important for us to be able to address that through different specialties and a team of doctors who collaborate to make the best patient outcomes. Thank you. Thanks, Stanley.
All right. One of the things that caught my attention was, of course, the fact that this entire mechanism can bring out the conversation about women's health among the women's circles. Tell us more about this.
Yes, we have a growing and very engaged community on social media and across our different platforms. And what we noticed is, and what our doctors and specialists also say, is that this population that we serve, which are mainly Gen Z and millennials, are very woke and are demanding for better services and quality services. So why can't we have that here? What we're trying to do is work across different sectors. Of course, we're a private company, but we support other agencies as well to mm-hmm. be able to promote family planning and other women's health topics better, because that's what our community needs and that's what they're telling us they need.
All right, we've spoken about quality health care and how the entire mechanism works. The other side of the equation, of course, is pricing. Now, some viewers might ask, what pricing are we talking about when you discuss about value for money for the services that you're offering?
Yes, Yes, definitely. And we do consultations with trusted specialists virtually and in person. Mm-hmm. And our consultations range from 500 pesos to 850 pesos. And for mental health, that's about 850 pesos to 2,500 pesos. We also sell contraceptives. We dispense birth control pill subscriptions, which is same as the market price.
Yeah.
And we also provide other contraceptives as well. We have health screening packages. But in summary, we are in the mid-range. We are definitely lower price than premium hospitals and private.
I was about to mention, because 500 pesos is like, that's the average range for the usual checkups.
Yes, that's right. And because we work with doctors who give us the flexibility to be able to give our customers more and incentivize them, we run promos from time to time as well, because we're able to work with doctors who are really advocates of women's health.
All right. Now, the pandemic was a big challenge for a lot of women. In fact, a lot of people, many businesses were facing uncertain economic times. How did it go for your group?
Yeah, we actually started during the pandemic.
So this was born out of that need, right?
Yes, exactly. We're a 1-year-old company. We're an early stage startup venture. And last year we were growing about 40 to 50% month on month. And we grew 1,000% year over year, which was a really great sign for us in building our two MVPs. And from January to February, we grew 200%, happy to share. And March will actually be our biggest month since this is our month, the Women's Month.
Yeah, so that really sounds exponential. Now, let's talk about the perspective from the grander scheme of things, healthcare in the Philippines, which I know there's so much to be desired as far as how this is being offered by both government and the private sector. And how do you think both parties can partner to make things better?
Yeah. And, you know, our goals are aligned across different sectors. We come together and we talk about promoting access to different family planning options and different healthcare services. We have Women's Month campaigns lined up with government agencies and even non-government and nonprofit to promote SRH or sexual reproductive health. And I think it's a great start in building great relations for the future of women's healthcare. But of course, there's a lot of work to be done, and a few companies and a few organizations cannot make significant progress alone. That's why it's important to work across different sectors in healthcare, private companies like us, government sectors like the DOH, and non-government institutions and organizations that we all support as well.
All right. Lastly, how can women viewers, especially those who are interested to learn more about women's healthcare, reach Kindred? And since it's Women's Month, Jessica, do you have any special activities lined up for them?
Yes, definitely. Thanks, Stanley. Thanks for letting me promote our website. It's mykindred.co. We're also about to launch a version 1 of our mobile app in a few weeks' time on iOS and Android. And our physical clinic is in the second floor of the Surrender Mall in Bonifacio Global City in Taguig. And we're planning to build out more clinics around Metro Manila and outside NCR as well. So stay tuned for that.
All right. On that note, Jessica De Mesa, co-founder and CEO of Kindred Health, thank you so much for joining us today. Have a great day.
Thank you, Stanley. Thanks so much.
Up next, a look at the PSE opening numbers. Chris Mangun of mangunonmarkets.com will join us for his analysis. Market Edge, we'll be right back. Asian markets opened higher after Wall Street notched gains due to a Federal Reserve official's less aggressive remarks on rate hikes. But both Australia's ASX 200 and South Korea's KOSPI index are up 0.2%, while Japan's Nikkei 225 is trading higher by 0.6%. Now, the early gains also come as investors digest the key release of economic reports. Japan's unemployment rate hit 2.4% in January, the lowest since February of 2020. Meanwhile, private survey data for China's services for February and India's factory activity will be released later today. The Philippine Stock Exchange kicks off trading at the 6,600 level after adding 0.2% in Thursday's trade. Now joining us today for his take on the market, Chris Mangan of ManganOnMarkets.com. Good morning, Chris. Welcome to Market Edge.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
It's good to have you here. Now, the index closed higher yesterday, but still a lot of pessimism from a couple of analysts we've spoken to, saying at least any rally at this point is hard to sustain. Now, what's your view on the equities market right now? Do you share the same view?
Well, I share the same view in the sense that we might not see a substantial rally in the short term. Mm. However, looking at prices, I think current prices are at justified levels. There is a lot of concern regarding runaway inflation. I mean, that's, in my opinion, the biggest negative factor for our market and the economy as well. Most analysts are expecting inflation for February to continue higher. Mm-hmm. And higher inflation is going to signal higher interest rates.
Right.
And that's what's diluting the sentiment at the moment. But despite that sentiment that the market might not go higher, I don't think it's going to go much lower either.
Right. Right. Why do you think so?
Well, just looking at current prices, like I said, I think current prices are justified, and there are no, by looking at the data, there's no signals or indications that our economy is not going to continue to progress. Mm-hmm. I think our economy is going to continue to recover and get stronger following our Asian peers like Indonesia and most other Asian economies that are reliant on the reopening of China and the recovery of the economy. So looking at current prices, we may see increased selling pressure that will take prices slightly lower. However, in my opinion, that's a buying opportunity.
All right. Now, do you see the 6,500 level as a stable support?
Well, okay. Looking at, since I do rely highly on the technicals, 6,500, 63 to 65 has always been a strong support level.
Right.
And that's going to continue to be the case. If prices do go lower, prices hovering at support is always a good buying opportunity.
All right. Of course, speaking of buying opportunities, a lot of investors are now in a better cash position after selling off in the past weeks. This juncture of waiting for buying opportunities at a specific level, and if, of course, 6,500 holds, would you recommend some buys, and what stocks or counters perhaps or sectors do you find cheap enough at these levels?
Okay, well, retail is going to continue to get stronger, I mean, as the economy also progresses. And there's several issues that are showing that right now. Mm-hmm. As the economy continues to get stronger, you're seeing prices go higher. Financials have been the darling because of higher interest rates. I think we're going to see more of a pullback there.
Mm-hmm.
The conglomerates, I believe, should start to go higher as well. Now, the property sector is where I see the most potential the most upside potential in the medium to long term. So I'm going to be watching out for these industries.
All right, Chris, you mentioned earlier about inflation setting the tone, at least for how the market's going to behave in the next couple of weeks. And we know for a fact that it is rising. February inflation is projected in the 8 to 9% range. Given that preview, a lot of government agencies have indicated that inflation is indeed going up. Is this now being priced in by the market? I mean, is this it?
Honestly, regarding inflation, I think I think the benchmark rate, I mean, the reason why it's high is because we're coming off a lower base from last year. But if you look at real world prices, if you look at the price of food, if you look at the price of gasoline, I think they're more stable than they have been. And because of that, businesses and the economy are starting to slowly progress because prices are more manageable. So yes, the inflation figure is a factor for investors, especially with capital markets. But I think it's going to, I think the effect, it may not be priced in, you know, I mean, the sentiment will still be affected negatively with those high inflation numbers, but I think it's temporary. I think the real, I think valuations right now are comfortable at these levels, and as the economy recovers, we're going to see prices go higher.
All right, Chris, let's talk about an ANZ research forecast. It says higher growth for the Philippines at 5.8%, seeing resilient domestic consumption even at unstable and elevated consumer prices. Now, while many Filipinos are harping about high prices, do you see any slowdown in spending at all this year?
Well, definitely. Prices are higher, but I don't think they're unstable anymore. I don't think we're going to see the same price shocks that we saw towards the end of last year. Well, I'm hoping at least, unless we have a major negative effect like a war. I mean, the escalation of the war in the West or something like that. But otherwise, I think prices are starting to move towards more stability. And as prices become stable, despite them being higher, I mean, the people are going to keep going. Yes, there may be people may be watching their spending now as well as businesses. But I think they're more well-adjusted now after 3 years of everything that's happened with the pandemic and these runaway prices. I think now more people are gaining confidence in and have learned from what's happened and are going to be more equipped to handle the current situation.
Okay, Chris, let's go back to the corporate scene now. It's still earnings season. A lot of investors are, of course, hoping for good numbers for full year 2022. So far, are you satisfied with earnings? Were they as you expected?
Yeah, well, a lot of companies did well last year, and I think they're going to do even better this year. So that drives a positive case for higher valuations.
All right. Lastly, let's talk about some of our big stories for today. Philippine electronics exports up 6.8% in 2022. Now, what's your outlook on electronics manufacturing at this time? I mean, is 2023 a year of recovery for the sector?
Well, yeah, they have been in recovery. There's still some logistical issues. And of course, unstable oil prices have been a large factor in COVID lockdowns. But I'm betting on this year to be more stable than the last three. I know it's kind of hard to be really optimistic. We've been trying to stay optimistic the last couple of years, but I think it's time that things return to some stability. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, yeah, for this sector, I'm hoping for the best. I'm hoping that the recovery and the progress continues all throughout the year.
Yes. Finally, Chris, we're 7 minutes into trading. Market's up 66.65. That's up 0.65%. What is your caveat for traders today?
Caveat for traders today? Well, I think the market's going to end flat. Prices are seeing less volatility. Mm-hmm. There's still a lot of trading. Have a good weekend, basically. I mean, we'll just have to keep hanging on. Market may continue to move sideways, but let's hope for the best.
All right. On that note, Chris Mangan, a senior analyst of mangan on markets.com. Thank you so much for joining us today. Have a great weekend.
Thank you, Stanley. You too.
Thank you. Moving on, time to zip through the top headlines from major business papers from Business World. The Philippine Central Bank is setting a deadline of June 30 for banks and financial institutions to fully adopt the National Quick Response Code Standard in a bid to accelerate digitalization. Now from Business Mirror, Cavitex Infrastructure Corporation has signed a deal with China Road and Bridge Corporation to construct the second phase of the 1.9-kilometer Cavitex C5 Link segment number 2. And from Wall Street Journal, America's largest retailers, Macy's and Best Buy, say consumers pulled back on purchases for apparel and electronics in recent months while continuing to spend on groceries and other necessities. Now, the powerful earthquake that struck Turkey and Syria has prompted calls for better construction of structures that are resilient to natural disasters. A local real estate developer is doing just that through the adoption of technology being used in Japan. For more on this and other developments in the property sector, we're now joined by Don Wei C. He's the Chief Operating Officer of Bamberton Development Corporation. Good morning, Don Wei, and welcome to Market Edge.
Good morning, Stanley. Thank you for having me.
It's good to have you here. Now, it's a reality that whenever a big earthquake happens, our structures come to mind, especially in Metro Manila, where you have the sort of perfect mix of population density living in questionable buildings mm-hmm. and homes. Now, from a real estate developer's perspective, just how bad is our situation?
You know, in the Philippines, currently our building code only mandates us to go up to a standard of up to, like, resisting a magnitude 7 or around that range of an earthquake. Mm. You know, as we all know, with the recent earthquake in Turkey just last February 6th, a 7.8 magnitude earthquake hit them, and they were caught unprepared. And in the Philippines, we all know the big one is coming. However, we can't just sit around and just hope for the best and hope that things don't happen, because we all know it's coming. We just don't know when. Mm-hmm. And we have to take proactive action in order to be able to resist such a devastating calamity that's in the waiting. It's just asleep, but then once it wakes up, we do have to face the realities of it.
All right. Go ahead, please.
Yeah. So I think we have a long way to go in the Philippines mm-hmm. to evolve, to grow, to have our infrastructure be better prepared to resist such an earthquake by improving our structural infrastructure and our construction.
All right. Now, there's nothing much that can be done with old structures except perhaps mm-hmm. for retrofitting and reinforcement. Mm-hmm. This is something that you recommend as well?
Yes, actually, that's exactly what can be done for our existing infrastructure. It may be a bit costly, but you count it as you treat it the same way you would an insurance policy.
Right.
Right. You pay for insurance, you pay for a premium with the hopes that it won't happen. But then if it does happen, then you're glad to have had that insurance in place. As we can see in Turkey, in that southern part of Turkey and the northern part of Syria, they weren't able to prepare for that properly. And that's probably because of some level of corruption that happened in the building code. And even though the contractors followed the building code and they properly constructed their buildings following what they were required of. However, even then, our current standards, their current standards, did not match up to the level of the magnitude of earthquake that actually could potentially happen. We actually, for our building, we installed the base isolation technology from Japan. Mm-hmm. It's with this kind of technology, it basically isolates the building in half. It segments the building into a portion beneath the base isolation that allows it to sway with the earthquake. However, the structure on top will no longer weigh as much. So essentially, the base isolation absorbs 80% of the shock and the vibration and the swaying that allows the building to be protected, and as well as the people inside of it.
And are there buildings like that already in the Philippines? I mean, are you seeing improvements in the way we build our buildings, complying with those standards and applying the technologies that you mentioned?
For the current landscape in the Philippines, we don't see anyone that's implemented this technology yet, and we're proud to say that we're the first high-rise to have first high-rise buildings to have installed this technology. Majority of the buildings in the Philippines, they apply a sort of shock-absorbing mechanism or vibration mechanism, normally in their upper floors. However, they don't have this degree of resistance or seismic protection as we have installed. Other buildings mostly just reinforced their concrete and their steel to make sure that the structure can resist an earthquake. However, as we can see, actually in Turkey, their buildings were relatively resilient. Some apartment buildings were constructed just 3 years or 4 years ago, like right before the pandemic, 2019. Those are quite new. And those were all apartment buildings. People were living inside of it. The structure was okay. However, they weren't built to withstand such a huge earthquake. There were a lot of buildings that withstood the first wave of the 7.8 earthquake. Mm-hmm. However, because there were multiple aftershocks that occurred, most of those structures were already compromised after the first quake.
Yes.
So cracks would have formed and some weaknesses would have been surfaced already.
Okay.
However, there's not enough response time for engineers and construction renovation to be able to quickly reinforce those buildings, those structures. So
okay.
When it hit for a second time.
Okay, please proceed.
So when it hit for a second time, they just simply collapsed.
Okay, now Don, we of course, many of the issues about getting technology like this is the cost or the price. I mean, is it costly to incorporate this kind of technology in construction?
Of course, with this technology, it's actually from Japan. It is relatively costly. However, there are benefits to it too, because even though you install this new equipment, this new rubber seismic protection isolation bearing underneath at the basement level of your structure, you do develop this. You do allow the structure above the ground to be a lighter structure rather than having to be a very heavy and reinforced structure. Because with that bearing absorbing the shock, you don't need the structure above the ground to withstand as much of the shock anymore, because it will be dampened by those rubber bearings underneath.
And Bamberton, of course, Development Corporation, your group is at the forefront of this mission to build quake-proof properties. What technology, or perhaps how do you intend to push this into mainstream use?
Indeed. So actually, with our discovery of this technology, we found it to be very revolutionary in the Philippines, very innovative. Mm. Even though in Japan it's been around for over 40 years and it's been over tens of thousands of buildings are already incorporating this into their structures. And of course, with our building being the pioneer, the first one to implement it, we hope to propagate this usage and promote the usage of this technology across our new constructions. Also, in fact, possibly for existing structures. We are happy to speak with more developers to help them supply them with this technology as well.
All right. Now, let's talk about the real estate development industry in general. We know it's been thriving pre-pandemic, but of course, the pandemic brought a lot of woes, including a higher interest rate. That kind of environment has stomped real property, the entire sector itself. Now, how do you present your case for integrity of homes and buildings when clients are worried about these costs?
Mm-hmm. This is always, it's like I said, it's similar to selling insurance. Mm-hmm. It's part of what we have to consider, but then, of course, we can provide variations of this type of technology for cyclic protection. It's not only the base isolation that is available to be used for developers looking to save a bit or only try a portion of it, then we could start with we could incorporate other technologies that are more affordable as a beginning. But then, of course, for more premium development, there's a scale of product that we can offer them to use.
And what do you think about government policy as far as, of course, government involvement is concerned? As you mentioned, we have a building code, but we have problems with some of the provisions there and even enforcement. Now, are you seeing the day that perhaps this would be part of normal operations when you talk about construction? We have government that endorses or even pushes to incorporate this kind of technology in construction.
Yes, indeed. Actually, we've seen a memorandum issued by the DPWH that they would like to incorporate this kind of technology into new government buildings in order to make them more resilient and, of course, more sustainable long term. That way, won't need to have incur a lot of renovation expenses for the structure. We hope for this to be a more common practice. That way, we could modify our thinking of and our treatment of seismic activity. Instead of hoping it would not happen, we would rather have it become the case that people would be confident in the situation, regardless of whether the quake happens or not. Because in Japan, when earthquakes happen, they treat it as a normal occurrence.
Right.
But over here, we still do the drop, cover, and hold. And right. In which case, you just hope for the best. You hide underneath the table and hope the structure of the table would protect you. But if the structure of the entire building collapses, then there's not much hope there.
All right. Lastly, and to close, Bamberton Development Corporation, what are its current projects and how do you envision the future in the Philippines?
So our flagship project of Bamberton Development Corp is in... It's called Bamberton Center, located in Arca South Taguig. We are very bullish for the Philippine economy and for the, of course, the real estate market in the Philippines. Even though it's currently going through a slump with the partial exit of the POGO, and we're not sure whether or not they will fully return. But we believe that with or without them, the Philippine economy is resilient. Our real estate market and industry is resilient, and we believe that we're here for the long game. Regardless of the slump, we know that when it troughs, eventually we'll have a recovery, and then we'll be on our way to growth.
All right. On that note, Don Wei-Si, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Switching gears now, Google joins the Philippines in honoring legendary Filipino writer Paz Marquez Benitez. A Google doodle of Marquez Benitez is featured on the search engine's homepage today. That's March 3 to mark her 129th birthday. Now, Marquez Benitez is famous for her work, Dead Stars, the first ever modern short story in English from the Philippines. She also founded what is now the Philippine Women's University, advancing the cause of women's education in the country. And that's it for the show. I'm Stanley Palisada. Thank you so much for watching. Stay safe and stay with ANC.
Because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no, and